And what's happening in at the moment is that the price of everything is going up. Yeah, I'm paying $4.50 for an oat piccolo. I'm driving past the petrol station and seeing fuel now almost at $2 as a given. You try getting a tradie out to do one little task and all of a sudden, you know, you're...
$1,200.
$1,200 in the red. And the cost of things is going up. Used cars are going up. 37% increase in the value of used cars. Used cars are... Buying a car is the worst investment you can make because it's a depreciating asset. All of a sudden, cars are going up. The used car market. And so what's going on out there? Why are real estate prices continuing to shoot the lights out when all the big banks and all the fancy economists last year said that they're going to fall by up to whatever? You and I sat on a podcast and said that's wrong. Mm. What's actually going on? And so what is going on is that there's inflation. Inflation is starting to creep in. And if you talk to a lot of people that have come from the Mediterranean, you know, if you come from a Greek, Italian heritage, if you come from a Lebanese heritage, a Turkish heritage, our parents and our grandparents experienced hyperinflation.
With the lira and...
Exactly. And so what I'm trying to do is to say, is our generation now going through a similar experience that our grandparents went through? And if we are about to, how do we invest for that and how do we protect ourselves and benefit from it as opposed to being threatened?
Can I just be contrarian for a second? Because I know we've got a lot of educated listeners that are reading the Fin Review and you know, ABS and economic data, and they'll say, hey, Peter, is that true? I saw that inflation has actually, is slowing down.
Yep.
It's come off. It's what, 0.6 or 0.8% or something. So what do you mean inflation is coming, and if the real data is saying that it's dropping?
That's a really good point. So the central bank, the Reserve Bank, watches a particular type of inflation, right? And so governments report a particular type of inflation. And usually if you have a look at the categories which they measure, there aren't really things that do go up in value, and they measure such a wide basket that sometimes some things go up, some things go other. So the official number, you're right, isn't large, but the number on the streets, the number from our pocket, the numbers that we're seeing in the way that we spend every day is changing. And so I'm pointing out to things outside of the official numbers.
Basket of goods.
Exactly, because at some point in the future, the official basket is going to change. And so we're together looking out and anticipating what happens 3 or 4 years from today.
No, I'm hearing you. And what I like best about this conversation is you say inflation is happening in assets, not just the basket. Just because your pear hasn't gone up in value and the cost of milk hasn't gone up doesn't mean that the money isn't going elsewhere and people aren't prepared to spend more on different things.
Yeah, 100%. Maybe, you know, milk is up only 2 cents, but if the house next door is up 250 grand in a month, well, what's more important? Milk going up by 2 cents or the house? Because when it comes to our assets and our cost of living, and we're at a stage in our life where we're building assets and providing for our loved ones, what matters is things that are outside of that basket.
Yeah, and it's interesting because, you know, they're talking about property prices, and for all of you listening out there, when I say they, I'm referring to CoreLogic, I'm talking to ANZ, Westpac, all the banking economists, and they talk about national figures, you know, 5, 6, 7, 9%, but that's as a national or as a gross average across the state. But in practical terms, if you're looking at specific markets, that ones that we're picking, you're seeing 20% price growth.
100%. And what they also do, Dom, is that they do something called seasonally adjusted. Mm. And so what they'll say is, oh, well, you know, there's one-off factors here and we'll adjust for it. But don't adjust for it because that's impacting me. Don't keep fluffing the number because of, you know, one-off. There's always one-off factors. And if you're going to adjust for one-off factors all the time, well, hey, that's not the situation again on the streets. So... things are starting to move. I'm looking for the anecdotes, and I want to talk today with you a little bit about the threats of doing nothing.
Yeah, well, tell me about it. So why is inflation a hidden tax? Like, why have you phrased it in this way? Why should people be concerned? And, you know, why is that a thing?
So a tax is basically a leakage of your wealth. Usually it goes to the government who redistributes that, and that's fine. I've got no problem paying my taxes to the government as long as the government's doing the right thing and they're not wasting money. We all benefit as a society from some form of taxation. Some people might have a different view. That's my personal view, right? But the tax of inflation is a different tax, and it's hidden. It doesn't come out of your paycheck from your employer, doesn't go to the ATO. But, you know, if you had $100 in 1980, it buys you a lot less today than it did back then. And so that $100 note hasn't changed. What's changed? Inflation has changed. There is now a taxation on me for having not invested or spent that.
Yep.
And so $1,000 or $100,000 today, if you've saved $50,000 in 2030 or 2040, that $50,000's not going to be able to buy you the same things that it buys you today.
Mm.
And so what happens is you're leaking wealth to a form of taxation. And it's a huge form of taxation if you're not being prudent and investing and adjusting yourself around that.
And it's a scary kind of taxation, because I liken it to that analogy where, you know, you put a frog in warm water and as you increase the heat, it eventually it boils to death and it can't jump out. I liken it to that because people have a sense of security whilst they're losing money. They've got $200,000 in the bank account. They feel that they are wealthy. They feel that they can do so many different things without knowing that whilst they're sitting on it, the value is going down, they're being taxed. And the second thing is there's all the opportunity costs that they're missing out on. So that $200,000 could have bought them a beautiful house and grown by 20%, making them $200,000 on $1 million investment. Or, and the last thing is they're becoming complacent, they're getting scared, and they're borrowing down. And we talk about this sometimes, how people are spenders or some people are savers. But if you sit in that mindset and you don't do anything, then you're just going to keep on doing nothing.
Doing nothing sometimes is good. When interest rates are at 10% or 15% and I can go and give my money to Commonwealth Bank and do nothing and get 10 or 15%.
Beauty.
Great deal. Doing nothing when you earn zero, or if you're lucky, 0.1, not a good idea, particularly when there's a lot happening out there in the streets that it's indicating that you need to be holding assets.